Panasonic Lumix GH6 Firmware Update version 3 is available, and the features they've added is mainly the ARRI LogC3, so you have to pay for it, and I think that's the product code for it, so DMW-SFU3A. So you pay separately for it and you buy the key, and then once you enter the key, then you can unlock the ARRI log feature. The firmware update also adds support for the new audio adapter, so the DMW-XLR2. Although, even though you can connect this audio adapter to the GH6, you won't be able to record 32-bit float with it. So a new audio adapter with better preamps and more options for connecting microphones. So it has a 3.5mm input as well, and the ability to adjust the gain on it with a mechanical dial, but there's no 32-bit float for the camera. And it also mentions other improvements, such as improved operational stability, and I think that typically refers to fixing of different types of bugs, which probably the company doesn't want to mention because some of the bugs are not widely publicized, so they don't want to publicize it any further. So the bug fixes and the support for the new audio adapter is free, but if you want to get the ARRI LogC3, then you have to pay for it separately. So this is the unlock key that you can purchase for the ARRI Log, and that's the price for the UK. And currently this is supported on the GH7 and the GH6. So what that means is that none of the improvements to the GH7 from the autofocusing options or the stabilization options have been carried across to the GH6, and the streaming capabilities have not been added neither. So I think from this point onward, we shouldn't expect any meaningful firmware updates to the GH6. If you want the GH6 to be better, then you just have to purchase the new GH7. Although I would say that for a flagship camera, for their Micro Four Thirds, I don't think the time span which Panasonic provided firmware updates was big enough or meaningful enough firmware updates. And personally, I would be happy to pay for firmware updates if they, for example, improved the autofocusing options or the stabilization on the camera, instead of paying the full price for a completely new camera that doesn't actually have many new features to worth doing the upgrade, whereas some of the features, such as improved stabilization or autofocusing options, would actually be nice to have on the GH6 for a smaller price than upgrading to a full new camera. There's a project called Switchlens on Kickstarter, and what they're doing is combining the idea of having a camera and a smartphone. So this camera will have a Micro Four Thirds mount and sensor, and it's similar to things that have come before it in terms of connecting to a smartphone and being controlled that way. So we'll see how this progresses. And they seem to have created a prototype already, and there's some videos on their page where they actually demonstrate that they're using it. So I suspect the firmware is quite advanced in the sense that they have a working prototype which is functional. So it's just a question of scaling the production and selling the camera. So we'll see how that goes in maybe 6 months or 1 year, whether people are using it and if it gets released, to see how good it is. Another camera which is in the same category in terms of working with smartphones is the Alice camera, and they announced that they're ready to ship in June 2024. Now, one thing about these cameras that work with smartphones, I think the idea is really good because everyone has a smartphone and people typically upgrade their smartphone, and the smartphones already have a really good screen which is larger than typical camera screens on the back, the LCD, and they also have a typically really high performing processor which can compute intensive tasks, whether it's AI algorithms or whether it needs to process images and video encoding or decoding. So if you can remove those elements from a camera, then the camera itself should become a lot cheaper and a lot smaller because it needs less components to, for example, keep it cool or provide power to it. So the camera could become substantially smaller and lighter. But all the cameras that have been released in this category of cameras, they're not actually smaller or lighter than cameras that are already available on the market. So here you can see the size of this camera. So it's about slightly over 11 centimeters wide and 4 centimeters thick and 8.5 centimeters tall. So it's not particularly smaller than let's just say a camera such as the EM10 Mark IV, so the Olympus OMD EM10 Mark IV, or even the full frame camera Sigma FP, or even the Olympus OMD EM5 Mark III. So right now, if you buy the Olympus OMD EM10 Mark IV, it's cheaper, it's lighter, and it has a lot more features, and it has its own screen. So it's difficult to justify buying this camera now when you have cameras that are lighter and have more functionality than this camera. But I do think that there is definitely room for these cameras to improve, to get to a stage where they can, in terms of price, definitely compete with other cameras, because if they don't need to include high processing power and a large high quality LCD screen on them, they will use less power in terms of battery consumption, and they can also be substantially smaller and lighter. I don't think we've reached that stage yet, but I think that could happen in the future, and I see all these cameras as prototypes or proof of concept getting to that stage, and the people who are buying them are not buying them necessarily to use it, but to support these projects and more just to be part of these novel ideas. So one of the areas which I think these cameras have missed out on is IRL live streaming. So these cameras could definitely do a lot of that. So where currently you have those Sony cameras, as well as there's a few different action cameras that people use for live streaming, I think these type of cameras could definitely replace that market, and they could be cheaper and better with a Micro Four Third lens as well. So you'd have the higher quality as well as low light performance that you get with the larger sensor and larger lenses. And you also could connect to the camera. And when you pair that with phones that can encode, let's just say H.265 or AV1, then there is something really useful and at the same time cheap. But right now, these cameras are more expensive, heavier, with worse performance in all areas. So I don't think it can be a consumer success yet. It's just in the prototype stage, and hopefully they'll get there. And there's been another Pentax camera. So this is a film camera. I think, again, this is a novelty camera that some people like because of the style or memories they have with older cameras. And there's also another Instax camera being released, which has a wider format for printing the pictures. So again, a novelty type of camera. And I think these cameras are becoming a little bit of a fashion thing right now. So we'll see how long the trend for these cameras will last. They seem like fun cameras to have and take a picture and have your picture printed immediately. But realistically, I don't think it's a good choice as a camera, unless you're just buying it for a bit of fun. So another thing I want to mention was these plastic grids that you can connect to your backpack to stop sweating. But the reason I'm mentioning it is not necessarily for this purpose, but I think these are good alternatives to use for IRL streamers to connect all the devices to, because it doesn't cover the devices, so they get more air. So maybe something to consider for those people who are doing streaming, to buy these instead of the things that are currently used, which has a full cover on the back. And you could obviously place this inside the bag as opposed to outside the bag, and all the devices would get some air in terms of keeping all the electronics cool.